think you'll find this very interesting. I hope you pay close attention. It's information you never were told in high school or college. Watch. I'll be back in a few minutes. This is Rothschild, Mayor Anschel Rothschild. Care not who writes their laws. 17. The Rothschilds get control of America's money. A traitor in the George Washington's cabinet by the name of Alexander Hamilton was an agent for the Rothschilds. When they set up a central bank in the USA and called it the first bank of the United States, this is established with a 20-year charter. In 1811, the charter for the Rothschilds Bank of the United States runs out and Congress votes not to renew it. Either the application for renewal of the charter is granted or the United States will have a war, says Rothschilds. President Madison said, however, the United States stands firm and the charter is not renewed, which causes Nathan Meyer Rothschild to issue another threat. Teach those impudent Americans a lesson. Bring them a war. In 1811 to 1814, Rothschild's attorneys lobbied and tried to force their way into American courts to effect the Rothschild Central Bank. As a result, sufficient states in Congress approved the original, now missing, 13th Amendment, which barred anyone claiming an honor or allegiance to a foreign citizen of the United States. The original 13th Amendment approved by sufficient states just before the war broke out. See the original missing 13th Amendment on the William Wagner Channel. In 1812, backed by Rothschild's money, Nathan Meyer causes the War of 1812. The Rothschild plan was to cause the United States to build such a debt in fighting this war that they would have to, and they did, have a bank. And they allowed the charter of the Rothschilds owned First Bank of the United States again. In 1816, the American Congress passes a bill permitting yet another Rothschild-dominated the second bank of the United States, and it is given a 20-year charter, just like the Rothschilds' international bankers, the original bank gangsters, wanted. The British war against America, therefore, ends with the deaths of thousands of British and American soldiers, but the Rothschilds get their bank. And they control what and who issues the money. In 1832, President Andrew Jackson, the seventh president of the United States, had a term, and he ran on the slogan, Jackson and no bank. This is the reference to his plan to take control of the American money system to the benefit of Americans. In 1833, President Andrew Jackson starts removing the government's deposits from the Rothschild-controlled Second Bank of the United States, instead deposits them into banks directed by Democratic bankers. This really angers the Rothschilds. This causes the Rothschilds to panic, and so they do what they do best, contract the money supply, causing a depression. President Jackson knows what they are up to and plans to end it. You are a den of thieves, vipers, and I intend to rout you out. By the eternal God, I will rout you out, said Andrew Jackson. In 1835, on January 30th, an assassin tries to shoot President Jackson. But both pistols misfire. President Jackson would later claim that he knew the Rothschilds were responsible for the attempted assassination. That's not in the history book. In 1836, following years of fighting against the Rothschilds and the Central Bank of America, President Andrew Jackson finally succeeds in kicking them out. In 1841, President John Tyler the 10th president of the United States. He goes on to receive hundreds of letters threatening him with assassination. In 1861, President Abraham Lincoln, the 16th president of the United States from 1860 to his assassination in 1865, approaches the big banks, but they want 24% interest to 36% interest on all monies loaned to fund the Civil War. Lincoln's very angry about the high level of interest, so he prints his own debt-free money and informs the public that this is now legal tender for both public and private debts with no Rothschild money. By 1862, April, we gave them a great blessing, and they ever had, said Abraham Lincoln. In 1862, President Abraham Lincoln discovers that the Tsar of Russia, Alexander II, was having problems with the Rothschilds as well. And the Tsar gives President Lincoln some unexpected help. Tsar issues orders that if either England or France actively intervene in the American Civil War and help the South, Russia, will consider it a declaration of war against Russia. To show that, he sent ships to the East Coast and to the West Coast. In 1865, a statement to Congress, President Abraham Lincoln states, "I have two great enemies, the Southern Army in front of me and the financial institutions in the rear." Later that year, on April 14th, President Lincoln is assassinated less than 2 months before. In 1881, President James A. Garfield, the 20th president of the United States, who lasted only 100 days because he died in office. However, control of the volume of money in our country is absolute master. By a few powerful men at the top, you will not have to be told. In 1970, the Rothschilds ordered the execution by the Bolsheviks and control of Tsar Nicholas II and his entire family in Russia, even though they've already abdicated. The Rothschilds got their revenge and ordered them assassinated by Lenin and his followers. This is both to get control of the country and an act of revenge for Tsar Alexander I blocking their world government plan in 1815. The last and current Central Bank of America, the Federal Reserve, is set up during the presidency of Woodrow Wilson. Wilson later regretted it. Kennedy recognized the threat of the Federal Reserve and decided to issue $2 and $5 notes. Executive Order 11110, which returned to the U.S. government. Backed by silver. By November 22nd, 1963, Kennedy is assassinated.
Primarily on covet means. for expanding its sphere of influence.
Do you have any question
on infiltration
who was really behind JFK's assassination?
Instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no secret is revealed. That is why the Athenian lawmaker Solon decreed a crime for any citizen to shrink from controversy. I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people, confident that with your help, man will be what he was born to be, free and independent.
Well, I'm wondering if you caught all that. Did you get what was going on? President Garfield was only in office 100 days before he was assassinated. There's a lot of talk about who assassinated him. What I'm concerned about is who was behind the people that assassinated him.